May I kindly request for the welcome address by our OST. Thank you.
Good evening to all of you. A warm welcome to Raj Nivas. Once again, we are meeting in this place as a part of lecture series. Honorable Lieutenant Governor had been out of station for 3 days, and Madam just arrived about 1 hour back, but still Madam is active, and Madam has joined with us for this lecture series. And she is a motivating and driving force for all of us. Ma'am, we are happy to welcome you for this program. I welcome Dr. Devdas Menon. So when I introduce myself to him, I said, I am Devaniti Das. He said, I am Devadas. So, in fact, when I talked to him, he was saying that he had been to this place some years back when there is some trouble with the structure. The arch was having some crack, so structure was little unstable. And he being a specialist in structural engineering, working in IIT, so he has been requested to come over here and give us advice how to strengthen the structure. So he is not only a specialist in diagnosing the problem of physical structures, but also I think he is also good in expert in identifying how to strengthen your spiritual structures. And I'm happy that he is going to tell us how to strengthen your spiritual structure by way of selfless karma. So many times we are motivated by various expectations, ills. So he says that the selfless action is very important to make you stable. A structure has to be stable. Your spiritual structure has to be stable when you have a selfless action. And apart from teaching civil engineering in Madras IIT, he is also focusing on inner transformation. And he is teaching two important elective courses on self-awareness and integral karma yoga, both very popular topics. And he has authored many books, and the important books being Spirituality at Work, Inspiring Message of Bhagavad Gita, and Stop Sleepwalking Through Life. Very interesting topics. So, sir, Dr. Devdas Menon, sir, I welcome you on behalf of Raj Nivas and also on behalf of Honorable Lieutenant Governor for this program. And we are thankful that you could spend your time to come over here and share with your thoughts, very important thoughts for a life-changing process. I welcome you on behalf of all of us. Let us give a good hand to him. I also welcome the senior officers of the administration, officers of Raj Nivas staff, and people who come from various walks of life, representing civil societies, NGOs, others. Ladies and gentlemen, I once again welcome you all for this beautiful program. Let us hear what Dr. Devdas Menon is going to tell us. Thank you.
Thank you.
Namaste. Dear sisters and brothers, the topic is the yoga of the Bhagavad Gita with a focus on Nishkama Karma. And the location is Pondicherry or Puducherry, as you call it now. which is the home of Sri Aurobindo. That's how I connect Pondicherry mostly. But more important, we are at the Raj Nivas, the center of Pondicherry, which is, or which has in the recent past, the last 3 years or so, really shown what Karma Yoga is in terms of active, or shall I say proactive, engagement at all levels, because finally even the beneficiary has to take part. And I was happy having come here early to witness two things. One, that the common man has direct access, and secondly, the wide range of programs that benefit all of us. We are all interconnected, and so unless everybody is happy, you and I cannot be happy. What is the main promise of the Bhagavad Gita? Well, it's basically to give happiness and peace and fulfillment to all of us. That's what we all want. Whatever be our desire, it's always a craving for a sense of completeness. In Sanskrit we say purnata. And whether it's a material desire, desire is kama, that's how the word nishkama comes, or even a so-called spiritual desire, the aim is the same. The aim is to have a sense of enduring completion. And the reality is, we don't experience that completeness. If we are very honest, we actually sense, we feel a sense of lack almost all the time. And we are looking for completion. And when we seem to satisfy our desire, we do experience happiness. And if you look at it from a psychological point of view, it's that sense of completeness comes because the separate self sense that we have seems to dissolve, and we connect, at least for some time, either in a relationship with another human being or with a community, or even acquiring material things. That which prevented us from experiencing completeness is dissolved. Now, I'd like to... I want to begin by saying that there is this craving in all of us, and that craving is essentially a craving for union with the source that is always complete. Whatever we do, that's the basic urge. And that is the meaning of yoga. It's a union. And karma is the means, one of the means to realize that union through actual engagement in life, in the world, and not running away from the realities of life, but actively participating. I want to begin with a small story which has many forms to it, but since I'm a structural engineer, I will choose a construction site as the location for the story. So as you know, the Taj Mahal, it's one magnificent structure. Some people may think it's not sacred enough, but Sri Aurobindo, in his Renaissance of India, which I strongly recommend all of you to read, refers to the Taj Mahal as the eternal dream of a love that survives death. That's the deeper significance of that wonderful structure, whatever opinions you may have about Mumtaz Mahal and all that. Well, this structure was made of marble, and it was 20,000 stone cutters were engaged, and artisans were engaged in this construction. And marble had to be brought all the way from Makrana in Rajasthan, and whoever planned this structure had a tremendous aesthetic sense and a sense of engineering planning. But essentially, it's the common man who does the hard work. So there was someone who was visiting the construction site, and he was just observing all the workers. So the first worker he saw was someone who was simply cutting the stone, a typical government clerk kind of attitude, or you see everywhere, couldn't care less, cutting half-heartedly, or more accurately, quarter-heartedly. And this man approaches, the visitor approaches this person and asks, "What are you doing?" He barely looks up, but he says, "Can't you see what I'm doing? I'm cutting stone. Cutting stone for a living." So that reflects one guna of the three gunas, qualities, which the Bhagavad Gita describes in detail. It's called tamo guna, tamas, which is a quality we all have. The student who goes to sleep in our classes cannot be blamed, because the tamo guna in prakriti has possessed that individual. Then he moves on and he sees there are some skilled workers, and he looks at someone who's sweating it out, who is a specialist apparently in the construction of minarets, and there are many minarets which have to be done carefully. And when he asks the same question, this time the worker looks at him, and this is the demonstration of rajoguna, rajas, rooted from the word Raja, the same root as Raj Nivas. So he first looks suspiciously, who is this person who's coming? Is he a person of importance? Will it help my future? And so he exhibits all the work he has done. He said, "Look, I'm a specialist of minarets. And look at the amount of work already done in this day," and it is true. But the observer was very careful. He could see that in addition to the obvious arrogance this man had, and though he had the skill, in his urgency to increase the numbers, and we all have these urgencies, even in academic institutions, there is pressure on us to publish. So you want to increase the number of papers you publish, and people should know. So you kind of overlook quality here and there, and this visitor could see that. And he said, "Very good," and he moved on. Then he moved on to a segment where there were the super skilled workers, and they were working on the main dome. And he especially liked one person who had a radiance about him. You know, he was really enjoying his work. And he was not in a hurry. But when the work was moving, there was a flow, and he could not stop himself. A kind of flow state. And so he would pick up a piece of marble, lift it up, reflect. And when he brings his chisel to break it, it breaks exactly the way he wants. You know, it has to be a curved shape. And he lowers it gently on the ground and smiles. Same question, what are you doing? Well, first, this person who was in a kind of reverie, who didn't even notice a visitor, looks at him respectfully and smiles. And he gives this magical reply. He says, he didn't say I, he says, we are building the Taj Mahal. There's a sense of vision, there's a sense of purpose, there's an enjoyment in the work being done, and there is no need for bringing forth the fact that he is the skilled labor, you know, he's bringing everybody into the picture. And that's an exhibition of sattva guna. So you'll find that all of us have all these three gunas. And in education, in life, it's important for us to purify ourselves, to develop our skills as best as we can. You can never, all three gunas are needed. But who is the Raja? Who is really governing? So you have to look into your own lives, your own how things unfold in your own life to discover what is going on. I once gave this talk at a women's college in Chennai. It was a Muslim college, and about 250 girls and all psychology specialists. And I was having a session with the faculty, and they said, one of them said, I've been reflecting on this, and I want to confess that even when I'm doing namaz, which they do five times a day, I find that my mind is not in what I'm doing. I'm probably just cutting the stone and not really, I'm not there. And so I need to upgrade the quality of my work. The purpose of this talk, if there is one, is really just to help us reflect on ourselves, not pass judgment on others, and to see what is it that we can do to upgrade our lives. And I also want to make some corrections to the popular notions of what a karma yogin is. Typically, who is a karma yogin? Well, we often say, look at him or her. That's a true karma yogin. We refer to someone who really works hard, who really contributes in whatever domain that person is a specialist in, who probably also does it for in the larger interest of society, who is dedicated, perhaps who is also spiritual, who consecrates the work to the divine, which is one aspect of karma yoga, who is altruistic, who follows norms, who doesn't violate norms. And you'll find there are only a few such people in society. In government, typically the joke is, and by the way, my institution is also a government institution, 20% of the people end up doing 80% of the work. Because finally, these people are the ones who get to, or are forced to do the work which other people are not quite doing. And if you are one of the older religious folk, then it also means to live a pious life, a sattvic life, to do your duty, to remember the divine. You also have been told that you should not accrue karma, because karma, you know, bandhanam is a big issue. And if you just surrender, Narayana yeti samarpayami, somehow everything will come to a good end and you will be freed from the cycle of rebirth. The assumption being this life is not a good place to be in. It's and the Gita also acknowledges this. Gita says, yes, anityam asukham lokam, that's the default nature. We were seeing in the videos, there's so much to clean up. So much. And the more you clean up, you realize the more the mess is. And so you get overwhelmed. It's not that I have to clean up my own house or my own body or my own, because I'm connected to everybody else. Everything has to be cleaned up. It's a Swachh Bharat mission, for example, is a very noble enterprise. And if we talk of all kinds of cleaning, not just material cleaning, but psychologically, emotionally, spiritually, it's a big project. And it's easy to give up. And it's easy to get depressed. It's easy to complain. And that happens to all of us, because we get frustrated. To do even small things, you have to keep provoking people and reminding them that this is your job, you've got to do it. And we realize that way of living makes us a little frustrated, sometimes agitated. And so we are not really accomplishing the promise of the Gita, which says you will be fulfilled. So I want to first explore that. What are we missing? Even when we are, first we assume that all of us want to do the right thing and to do this karma as best as we can. Are we really doing Nishkama Karma is the first question we should ask. And secondly, why is it that we tend to often feel frustrated? So there are certain limitations, and I would like to note the limitation. The first limitation is restlessness. You'll find people who are used to working a lot suffer from a fever of restlessness and anxiety, which means we are not living in the present. The present is incomplete. A lot of things to be done to find peace and harmony, which is true in a sense. But then we are so obsessed with what is unfolding with the future that we forget to enjoy the peace and joy that is ever present. And so there's an endless seeking and consequent suffering. And sometimes you might end up as a workaholic. A workaholic is not a karma yogin. Karma yoga has two parts to it. There is karma, which is work, and there is yoga, which is a union that promises fulfillment, peace, happiness. We have to reflect which of these parts is our center of gravity located in. If our center of gravity is located in karma, then you cannot be a karma yogin. You're doing karma. And that same is true with bhakti and jnana. It is a yoga which connects everything. And unless the yoga is there, and that only through self-reflection, self-awareness, self-inquiry, you know. And how do you know what you're doing is what you're meant to do? The Gita talks especially about Swadharma and Paradharma, no matter how attractive it is. You find many of our engineers who are trained in engineering colleges, in engineering, ditch what they are taught because of the promise of a good status in life, clean money, more money, and they migrate into fields where really it may not be their life calling. So, only when you connect to your innermost being will you even know what your Swadharma is. So, if you ask me, one takeaway that you could take from here is to ask this question. And if you really want happiness and fulfillment, which we all say we want, shift your focus to yoga. And do karma as and when required in the best way possible. And that can actually shift your perspective. And I want to add this. It's not possible to get rid of these limitations by doing karma alone. That karma must culminate in jnana and bhakti. If it does not, there will be this dissatisfaction, this perennial dissatisfaction, which the American poet Thoreau called, he said this, the great mass of men live lives of quiet desperation. So there's a constant unease. The second problem, which the Gita focuses bang on, is we are too obsessed with the fruit of action, karma phalam. If the fruit of action is not there, why should anyone do any karma at all in the first place? A very logical question which our students ask. And it is true, we are normally motivated to take up any action because we want to see some result. And there's really nothing wrong with it. The problem is when we get obsessed and we are attached to the result and we say, it must happen this way. So Gita says, you're getting it wrong if you're attached to the fruit of action. And this concept was very well known in the Asian spiritual traditions, in Taoism, in Buddhism, in Zen. So I want to narrate a small poem by Chuang Tzu, who was the disciple of Lao Tzu, a Taoist, the founder of Taoism, contemporary of the Buddha, just across the border. By the way, borders are all in the mind, they don't really exist. So this is how it goes. When an archer shoots for nothing, he has all his skill. If he shoots for a prize of a brass buckle, a small thing, he goes nervous. If he shoots for a pot of gold, some award, Padma Shri, he goes blind. His skill has not changed, but he thinks more of winning than of shooting. And the need to win drains him of power. A very poignant message that the fruit of action can make you nervous. People who attend interviews know that. You try to second guess what the interviewer wants you to answer and you don't give authentic answers, and the interviewer really knows you inside out. We had a friend in IIT who was a good cricketer, and the Nawab of Pataudi had come for the interview. So when he was asked a question, what is your favorite game? Like a fool, he didn't say cricket because he was afraid of the question. So he said chess. He was pretty sure Pataudi won't be knowing about. But Pataudi was an expert in chess as well, and he was easily exposed. So the need to be authentic above everything else is another message of the Gita. The third limitation that I've identified is that there is this strong sense of ego identification, which you saw in the Rajasic stone cutter. I am doing this. And you would like your name projected above anything else. So there's a strong sense of doership, a kartritva bhava, arrogance, and a distrust of others. And there's this conflict that will always emerge. And this is a big problem in undertaking projects. In IIT also, we like to do social work, and we've observed. Let's say we take a noble project like bringing water or electricity to some remote village. The students are interested, you know. We've developed solar energy plants. We've developed facilities which can convert any water, no matter how polluted it is, to drinkable water. We've even now developed a facility which is going to be a breakthrough where we can take what water from the air and convert it to drinking water. These are the inventions that are being done. But the objective is we want to help society and we want to go there. So everybody is interested. There are NGOs pitching in. There's the government also pitching in. There are ministers which come to contribute. But when you actually get going, and you know, there's a noble object, it gets into problems. And the most common problem everywhere is an ego problem. And the simplest version of the ego problem is, I'm doing all this work, he is not doing anything, and he's getting the credit for it. That is a normal karma we do. It's not nishkama karma, it is pakka sakama karma, full of ego motivated desire, which is a sure guarantee that you will suffer, because life is like that. And the sense of distrust. The next limitation I feel is this perennial feeling of lack, of agitation. And the Gita says a Karmayogin must also practice samatvam. The verse is samatvam yoga uchyate. Another name for yoga is samatvam, equal to sukha dukha. Very difficult. But primarily, the real problem is a lack of freedom. Freedom from what? Freedom from attachment to the fruit of action we saw. And the Gita keeps emphasizing, tyaktva karma phalasangam, the attachment to the fruit of action, give up. Freedom from ego-motivated desire, which is actually the heart of nishkama karma. Freedom from the duality of attraction and aversion, raga dvesha. Freedom from the sense of separation and insecurity. And so, how do we get this freedom? In fact, that is the purpose of education. That is a that is something that we should inculcate. The famous saying, sa vidya ya vimuktaye. Knowledge is that which can liberate us. Where do we get this liberating knowledge? Even in the universities where we study, this is not the liberation we get. We get more into difficulties. So it's so important that we have jnanis, as we did in the times the Gita was there, who at least hold this in position. This kind of vidya is referred to as paravidya. And it's not something that can be taught, but it's something that can be inspired. The vidya that is taught, including engineering, is all aparavidya, which is actually, in the Upanishadic context, is another kind of avidya. It doesn't liberate you. But the word vimuktaye also has another meaning of feeling unlimited. So in the early stages of education, it's important to develop that skill, that mastery in some domain, any domain, so that you feel that there is a contribution that you can do in the world. And you feel fulfilled only when you do it, and the potential is infinite. Arjuna, for example, if you take the archer story, Arjuna was not distracted by any award. He was always getting the bullseye. But how many Arjunas we have? And so it's important to nurture the sattvic temperament, to see the big picture, as we saw in the Taj Mahal story, with clarity, seeing unity in apparent diversity, knowing what is dharma and adharma, when to act and when not to. We need not act all the time. To have a steadfast resolve, to be self-controlled. And when we act, ideally every part of our being should align with that action. So the word in Gita is sarva bhavena. If we are driven by greed and lust, it's a natural corollary that we will end up indulging in corrupt practices. And that's the bane that we have to live with and correct. And doing work that needs to be done, not all work. So Gita says, karyam karma, work that needs to be done without attachment, without desire or aversion, and not focused on the fruit. Doing work as a sacred offering, not showing off, which is often what we do. Self-effacing, that's a beautiful word in the Gita. Anahamvadi, doing it quietly in the background, unaffected by success and failure. And the happiness that emerges from this, the Gita says in the end, is a calm delight emerging from the soul. Atma buddhi prasadajam. And here's the key to happiness. The happiness we are looking for is really not out there. Our work is best done when it's a celebration of a joy that is already inside you. And this awareness that it's not something outside you is something that all mystics have intuitively realized. And today happens to be Guru Nanak's 550th birthday. And it's good to recall him. He is one known for this, and Kabir, who was equally associated with him, was famous for this. And so that famous doha of his, Kasturi Kundal Base, Mrig Dhunde Vanamahi. Kasturi is a fragrance that is actually extracted from the entrails of a species of deer. In Tamil, we say Kasturi Man. And in the poet's imagination, the deer can sense it. So there is this fragrance. But he is searching for this fragrance all over the forest. Aise ghat ghat Ram hai, dunya dekhe nahi. Like this, all of us are outwardly looking, you know, where is, in which position of power will I get this kasturi? You can see what's playing out in Maharashtra now. Everywhere, which job will give me this kasturi? Which relationship will give me? And everywhere we go, we are bound to be disappointed, because yes, we do taste some happiness, but for some time, it doesn't last, and it can quickly turn to its opposite. So is a enduring happiness possible? Yes, says the Gita. And there's a powerful verse, which is what I'm going to talk on. It says, Tyaktva karma phala asangam. First, give up attachment to the fruit of action, and nitya tripto nirashrayaha. Nitya tripta. What a condition. Nitya means always. Tripta means contented. But there's a catch to it. It says, nirashrayaha. Ashraya means support. We all want an ashraya. The lieutenant governor is an ashram for everybody. But the Gita says, that will make you dependent. That will not give you the happiness that is already in you. And any dependence will bring you suffering. In fact, the whole purpose of education is to bring in this self-reliance, to show, yes, you can take care of yourself. You can not only take care of yourself, you can contribute to the world. And that, to understand that, is the next important thing. That needs what is called jnana. And the kind of jnana we are talking about is not covered in our education. So the Gita is not just a yoga shastra, a manual of discipline, practice, you know, abhyasa, vairagya, but it is also brahma vidya. If you see at the end of every chapter, it is said that this chapter is all about Brahma Vidya, Yoga Shastra, and Sri Krishna Arjuna Samvada, which is a dialogue between the human and the divine, or in this case also two friends. So let's not miss out on that. And to me, that is what is missing in our education, the access to Brahma Vidya. What is this Brahma Vidya? Well, if you, since the Gita is also referred to as an Upanishad, it's actually a nectar of all the Upanishads put together. Let's go back into ancient times and we realize that the Vedas had two parts. The main part, the bulk of it, was called Karma Kandam. Again, karma, it's all about doing the right thing. There are rules, there are methods, and if you follow that, hopefully you will be happy. And the story goes that intelligent people, and typically they are young people who are observing everybody, they say, something is missing. Even if I practice dharma the way it is prescribed, and I satisfy my needs for artha and kama, which are legally allowed, why is it that I see that people are still not fulfilled? Something is wrong. And the teacher says, I'm so glad you could observe this by yourself. And that's how the Upanishad starts. The Upanishad says, now you're an adhikari, you're fit to know that that which will complete your understanding is the fourth purushartha, which is moksha. Now the emphasis in traditional Vedanta is to focus on self-realization. But the Gita points to the fact that that's not enough. You also, having realized who you are, go back in Karma Kandam and you're a different person now. And it is then that you can practice Nishkama Karma. You cannot practice Nishkama Karma as an Ajnani. And so it's important for us, if we want to upgrade, if we want to find fulfillment, we need the help of the two other yogas, Jnana Yoga and Bhakti Yoga. And of course, we know that Jnana cannot be taught as such. You cannot answer a question paper. But you have, it's already there in you and you need to access it. I hope I have time. How much time do I have? Yeah, so but unless we have exposure to the Jnana part. So shall I continue or 10 more minutes?
Absolutely.
Okay. So there's this famous story of Shvetaketu. I'll cut short the story. The father asks the son, do you really want to know what Brahma Vidya is? What is Brahman? Then he gets into an experimental mode. They're sitting under a tree, a peepal tree. And he says, go pick a fruit from that tree. How did this tree come out? That's the first question. And the correct answer, from a seed. So let's take a look at the seed. Go and pick a fruit. So the son, who's a 16-year-old boy, Shvetaketu, goes and picks a seed. Picks a fruit. Says, break it open, pull out a seed. Pulls out a seed. And he says, what's the magic? Because the whole tree, the huge, gigantic tree has come from the seed. Why don't you break it and report to me what's inside the seed? And the boy does that. And he says, I can't see anything. From that apparent nothingness, this huge tree has emerged. From that, this world has emerged. From that, you and I have emerged. You are that. Tat Tvam Asi. We all know the story, we teach it, but unless we internalize this, it's no use. So, to internalize this, we have to understand the difference between sat and asat, which the Gita emphasizes a lot. In fact, we have the famous prayer, asato ma sat kamaya. What does it really mean? What is sat and what is asat? Any existence which changes, which is mutable, is asat. Now tell me, do you have any experience of anything that doesn't change? Everything around you is constantly changing. Even your belief systems are changing. Your body is changing. Your thoughts are changing. Some changes, like the movement of your breath, happen in nimisha. Some take days, some take months, some take years. And finally, this body is going to perish. That's the ultimate change which we are afraid of. From dust to dust. So the Gita says, that which changes, existence which changes, never exists by itself. Na vidyate bhavaha. But that which is, sat, the pure existent, never ceases to be. Na bhavo vidyate sataha. And the seers of reality, the tattva darshibhi, never fail to distinguish between this. Problem with us is we see everything as mixed up. How do we experience anything? What are the experiences we can have? First, the experience of the world. We experience because of the jnanendriyas. There are sights, there are sounds, there are textures, there are smells, etc. The other experience are body sensations. Then we have desires, we have thoughts, we have emotions, we have feelings, intuitions perhaps, memories, images. But what's the real stuff of that? They are all asat because everything is changing. Nothing is reliable. And we have put our ashraya on that asat for our happiness. You see the irony of this. A jnani can see it immediately. Because that which is supposed to offer you a support is itself unreliable. It doesn't last. And yet, tat tvamasi, you are looking in the wrong place. Your very nature is happiness, peace. You are too much outwardly occupied to even pause and trace yourself into your source. So I want you to just close your eyes. When you close your eyes, you are shutting off the visual field which really occupies our mind space. And let's focus on sounds. You're now hearing the gentle whirring of the fans, the sound of my voice. Distant sounds, sounds nearby. And every single sound comes and goes as a pulsation. Where does it come from? And where does it go into? Into some field, vast field, which is actually silence. Where do you feel the sound? Is it far away or is it closer than close? we feel the sound through awareness. We are aware of the sound. We simply know the sound, and that knowing takes place here. The rest is all speculation. If we were newborn children, we would not even use words like fan, voice. We would feel the vibration, and we would be curious, but it's all here and now. That's the only place we are ever located. If you free yourself from concepts, from nama rupa, if you take another chitta vritti, vritti is vibration, chitta is consciousness. Like thinking. Thoughts come and go. They are also asat. Where do they come from? And where do they go to? They come from that field of awareness which we are referring to as tat, tat tvam asi, and they disappear into the same field. If there's anything that doesn't change, it is that field. And the nature of that field is pure being, sat, and pure knowing, chit. If you now go back to hearing, are you moving from one field to another field? Or have you always been in the same field? Spacious, empty awareness. You've always been there, the rest is all speculation. And what is the nature of this field, this tat? It's like the space in this room. The space in this room is not affected by the quality of people sitting here. They may be rajasic, tamasic, sattvic. The space is not affected, and it equally welcomes all of them. They all come and go. If this building were to be broken down, and someday it will, because the building itself is asat, that space would remain unaffected. If you build walls inside the building, it may look like the space is getting divided, but that division is a mental concept. Nothing is divided. There is only one cosmic space in which everything is playing out. And whatever is emerging is actually emerging from that space and returning to that space. There is no element in our experience other than awareness, other than pure knowing. This is what the tattva darshibhi knows inside out, lives inside out. His happiness, nitya tripta, is guaranteed because it is nirashraya. And yet, when there is work to be done, it will be done. But there is no separate doer doing the work. The notion of the doer is just a collection of thoughts. Who are you? You are just perpetuating an idea in time. And time itself is an idea that thought produces. The newborn baby does not understand time. In deep sleep, which is a wonderful state that many of us crave to get into, we are willing to throw up all our attachments to enter that state, and that state comes when it will. We enter into a timeless space. We enter into tat tvamasi. In dreams, things get added on, and in the waking state, some more things get added on, and we feel reality. So into consciousness, mind enters and matter enters. But the substance, the sat of everything is pure being. Sat, chit, ananda. Its very nature is ananda and it is nirashraya. Ramana Maharshi, who did not live far away from here, discovered this by himself without any learning, and he chose to be in that state. And in that state, whatever happened in experience never could eclipse that understanding. In our case, we taste it, but then we are again lost in experience and we forget who we are. So I want to mention an incident. There was a person called Rangachari. He was a Telugu pandit at a college in Vellore. He once asked Ramana Maharshi, what is Nishkama Karma? Ramana was self-taught, but he knew everything. But he was a jnani. And he was a jnani who would not like to talk. So as usual, he did not give any answer. After some time, he just got up and went for a walk. As he walked out, and naturally everybody followed him, they thought he's going to demonstrate something. We don't know what was in his mind. He walked, he climbed a hill, and he sat down. And so everybody also sat down near him, expecting the master to show something. But his mind was blank as usual. Totally content, nityatripta, nirashraya. Then he picked up a long branch which was lying near him. And he saw some leaves also lying near him. So he just picked it up and started vigorously removing the bark from the branch, breaking the small twigs. And he started enjoying the work and he got into a flow state. And that whole branch was straightened out into a polished, you know, like a cane. So beautiful thing. You would love to decorate Raj Nivas with items like that, especially when made by these masters. And then he just looked at it, no pride, nothing. And he was wondering what to do. And then some boy was coming with some cattle, shepherding the cattle. But apparently he was using his hands because he had lost his staff with it. So Ramana waves at that boy, calls him, gives him this masterpiece, gets up and walks back to his ashram. And this pandit reports, he said, I got my answer. This is Nishkama Karma. But we live in the world, we have jobs, we have households to look after. How do we practice this Nishkama Karma in real life? But we have to see action in inaction and inaction in action. I just want to end with Bhakti Yoga, because Bhakti really completes everything. The Bhakti Yoga in the Gita is not what you think it is. The first lines in the 12th chapter is Advesta Sarva Bhutanam. Look at the words. Advesta. Advesta means no dvesham, no ill will, no hatred. Not to human beings. Sarva Bhutanam. To all sentient living beings. Advesta Sarva Bhutanam. So first begin with no ill will. Next, Maitra. Look at this. Friendship. Mitrata, Maitra Karuna, Karunyam, which is compassion. Maitra Karuna Evacha. Nirmamo Nirahankaraha. Nirmama means free from the feeling of mama, mine. Nirahankara, from the feeling of I-ness, doership. Nirmamo Nirahankara, Samadukha Sukha. This is the definition of Bhakti Yoga. You see, so karma and jnana come in there. Sama, dukkha, sukha, equipoise, whether you have success or failure. And it ends with Kshami. What is Kshami? Forgiving. Have concerns for other people's concerns. Don't nurture hatred, grievance. The next verse, Santushtah Satatam Yogi. Santushtah Satatam is like saying Nitya Tripta. Satatam Yogi, accomplished worker. Yatatma Dridha Nishchaya. So he is clear about what needs to be done. Decisively takes action. Mai arpita mano buddhihi, who has surrendered everything to me. This is the Purushottama speaking. That is the essence of Bhakti Yoga. Bhakti Yoga is all about supreme surrender. Yo mad bhakta same priyaha. Such a devotee, such a jnani bhakta karmayogin is who I am, is dearest to me. So if you take the four types of devotees, the highest devotee is one who is equal to the divine, through whom the divine operates. And so we must not be rigid, we must bow. And you have these beautiful words, manmana bhava madbhaktaha, madhyaji mam namaskuru. Manmana bhava madbhaktas, before you take any action, align yourself with me. What does Ishvara want? Is it aligned or is it what you want? Not my will but thine be done, we know in the Bible. So have we ever paused to find out whether our actions are aligned to something higher? Mam namaskuru. Namaskuru really means not just prostrating, but it means becoming plastic, allowing a divine energy to flow through your being. And then the supreme surrender. Sarva dharman parityajya mam ekam sharanam vraja. So, whenever you have confusions about your dharma, what to do, what not do, be a yogin. Completely surrender to me. And then what happens? I will do what needs to be done through you. And that's how this wonderful line, Nimitta Matra Bhava Savya Saj. Just be the occasion, just be the instrument, and the divine will play through you. And then you see that everything is Tat, everything is divine. Vasudeva Sarvamiti. I'll end with one last story about Tansen. I've heard Tansen, the great singer in the court of the Shahenshah Akbar. Akbar was very fond of him and he was very proud of him. What a great singer. So once he had a friendly conversation with Tansen and said, "You sing so beautifully, you know, classical Hindustani music. Who was your teacher?" "My teacher was a great soul, Swami Haridas." "So summon him to the court. I want to listen to him." So said, "Shahenshah, he is not the type who can be ordered around." And he said, "He wouldn't give two hoots to your order." Then Akbar reflected. Now, Akbar had a taste for all these things. He said, "Look, then I'll go to him. You come with me." He said, "He will not entertain you." He says, "I will go in disguise." And you know, Akbar used to do that. He said, I'll go as an ordinary person." And so they went. But with his intuition, Swami Haridas could guess who's coming. And he was in some cave somewhere and they go there and he receives not Akbar, whom he pretends not to know. And he tells Tansen, "Wonderful to see you, Tansen. I heard you have joined some big court and you're singing praises of some emperor and all that. That's your full-time duty. Tell me, what do you want?" He said, "He has come. The emperor has one wish only. He just wants to hear you sing." And like Ramana Maharshi, he keeps quiet. But Akbar is also very determined. You know, he won't let go. He sits there. He says, "Until this man sings, I won't get up from here." So they stay 1 or 2 days. Then on the third day, early morning, Akbar wakes up to the sound of music. It's so stunning, the sheer power and majesty and the flow of the raga, full-throated song. And this man sang for a couple of hours, apparently in bliss, and everybody is in a reverie, Tansen, Akbar, and suddenly the sound stops. Immediately Akbar goes, he wants to fall at the feet of Swami Haridas and congratulate him, but when he goes there, the man is gone. Anaham Vadi, vanished. Then Tansen says, that's my master. He doesn't need any praise, he doesn't look for anything. He does what the divine wants him to do. And your wish has been granted, let's go back. So they go back. Akbar is in a reverie for 1 month. At night when he goes to sleep, he can't help but listening to this. And one day he tells Tansen, look, you're a student, surely you can sing the same song. I want you to sing it in the court today. Tansen says, no, master, you will compare me with him and you'll know immediately that I'm no good. He said, no, my order. And so Tansen attempts. And really, he sings very well. Everybody in the court applauds. And Akbar is also finding himself applauding, but not fully. And in a personal dialogue, he says, you sang very well. If I had not heard your master, I would have said, this is the best music I've ever heard. But unfortunately, I could not help but compare. And I'm sorry to say, you are nothing compared to your master. And Tansen says, that's the best compliment that I could ever receive. And he said, but tell me, what's the difference between your singing and his singing? So the difference is, I'm singing to please this Shahenshah, this temporary emperor of a temporary land. Whereas he sings for the real Shahenshah. And it is not he who is singing. It is that Tat which is singing through him. That is Nishkam Karma. Hari Om.
Honorable Lieutenant Governor, Professor Menon, my colleague secretaries, ladies and gentlemen. The topic of today's talk is evergreen topic. It's relevant in all times, all days. Very, very important. When we talk of religion, there are various facets and many times controversial. Sometimes you would feel whether one should connect to it or one should not connect to it. And there are religious fault lines. No, I am only speaking for myself. But when it comes to Gita, it is such a quote-unquote secular thought. It just connects you with reality. And of course, reality is very complex, as Professor was trying to explain. And it is so complex, and that we need to admit, that there are only few people who have surpassed that boundary and reached that level of awareness. Raman Maharishi was one of them. I have been to his ashram a couple of months back, and I heard about him from someone who who knew about his life. Reaching that level of awareness is difficult. But in very, very simple terms, what Gita says is that Nishkama Karma, I mean selfless approach to what you do, not with expectation, and also not, it is not that you do it just in a random manner. That is also not probably the thought. But it is much more you do and remain connected with God, remain connected with Supreme Being, as if you are, I mean, in a lower kind of a thought, it is if you say it is a kind of a dvait philosophy, there is a God and He's watching you. And since He's watching you, we have to be better careful, and whatever we do, it has to be within the confines of those parameters which God would typically, one would assume, expect. But in case of Advaita, you become like a God. You become God. There is no difference because you have crossed that boundary. To my mind, this is very theoretical, and at least till now I have not been able to reach even that level. It's complex, it is a theoretical thought, it's a philosophical thought. But when it comes to Gita, in simple terms it says that you do with full devotion, full dedication, what you think is right, and go beyond the things which bind us down. A big challenge, but probably it is much more easier to understand than the other thought, which many yogis and experts say, okay, you can do it, but you need guru. And then if you ask him, where is that guru, then that also he will not tell. So it's a very, very, very ongoing exercise, very confusing. And sometimes you think, in Hindi they say Brahm. You find whether that is the Brahm, I am being put into that kind of a Brahm, what is it? I am talking about those who are at very common pedestal. That is another kind of Brahm, that I am being told something is good, but I am not being told as to how to go about it. So Gita is much more, I would say, simpler thought. It says, it basically, as it is narrated here, it talks about bhakti, it talks about gyan, even in our affairs which we in public administration we come across gyan, knowing not just that bigger gyan, but also knowing what surroundings we are living in, being aware of our surroundings, be it nature, be it environment. One should be connected with that. It is not always probably good to only talk in very, very telepathy manner, but it makes even more sense that we connect to our roots, we connect to the nature, we connect to the simplicity in life. In fact, one of the things that impressed me in Raman Maharishi Ashram was simplicity of ashram. It's very simple. I mean, even when you take food, people are around, you are one of them, and such a simplicity, it impresses you. What we are losing today is the complexity. Complexity in our thoughts, complexity in our functioning, and since we are becoming complex, the other side is also becoming complex, and it is a competitive complexity. Probably there is a need to have a more simpler, good old kind of a thought process where we can understand each other and learn from each other, being close to the nature and being true to Gita's message that we do our level best and with not a sense of that, I am doing it, probably something will come by. Of course, we are all human beings made of flesh and blood. So it is also probably impossible to honestly say that that kind of a chain of thought will not come. It's very likely chain of thought would come sometime or the other, that there is probably some expectation. But yes, the ultimate scenario is when you do it for the sake of it, you enjoy the work, you enjoy doing it. That is basically, in very simple terms, what I would say Gita says. And if you read Gita, I have not been able to complete it in one go, sometimes read some part. It is tough to understand. Not very tough, but you have to ponder over what does it say. But I would rather give credit to our people who have converted into more didactic kind of a thing where it gets mixed up with the storyline of Mahabharata. And then you are able to connect. Oh, that character is probably of that kind. This character is of this kind. And then the dots fall in line. So I am not able to, and as a book of very high order, very difficult to, for me, to look at it in as a standalone thing. It makes sense to me, much more sense to me, when it is part of that whole epic Mahabharata. And so then you get to see, oh, this is what is bhakti. This is what you can link, that this was bhakti, this was jnana. So I think I would not, I thought just of expressing my own limited thought. I will not take much time. It was a pleasure to listen to you, Professor Saab. I was slightly late. There was a meeting. I apologize. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you for this opportunity, ma'am, to actually express my thoughts over this lecture. And thank you, Professor Das, for sharing such a beautiful lecture. I was actually in a trance after you finished. And I did happen to actually close my eyes and actually pray to God that if I could actually attain that level, you know, where I could actually, it was the God which was doing actions through me. Thank you so much for your lecture. That is one of my takebacks.
Thank you, ma'am, for the opportunity. Chief Secretary, sir, and other colleague secretaries, and all the distinguished guests down here. The most important key takeaway for me today was reaching that level of Nishkama Karma. Actually, it is like, it's more an idealistic stage, but having heard you, sir, now one can possibly strive for it, and making an initial action to attain that is like half the battle won. That's what I believe. And it was really very nice hearing you and going through the thoughts. And this will remain in my mind for a very long time. Thank you.
So, namaste. It makes a big difference when some scholar speaks and then when some practitioner speaks. So that's where the this talk was coming straight from his heart. On Nishkama Karma, I would say, coming from Sri Aurobindo and the mother, at one place, the mother says, the Nishkama Karma, no one does. It happens spontaneously. And when it happens, there is a soul touch. And the psychic, she says, psychic, the antaratman, dances with joy, that the whole being is filled in with ananda. And then there is no sense of kartrutva, there is no sense of doership, there is no sense of this separative ego sense that I did. and one gets filled in with energy. So if these are the experiences while, you know, when we know that, okay, some nishkama karma has happened through us. And Gita is very affirmative that it's not meant only for some specific people. It's meant for all. Open yourself and then you get that energy from that supreme we call Krishna. Thank you.
Dr. Menon, thank you. We know you changed your travel plan for us. Asha told us. Want to thank you on behalf of all my colleagues here, all my friends and Puducherians who are present. You've come all the way from Chennai to educate us and make us aware of ourselves. My personal thought, as I've grown with, that those of us who are in government service, particularly of our kind, not in political service, administrative service, are in a fantastic position to do nishkam. I think we are blessed with this administrative service which we have. One, it's 100% secure. It is going to be with us till we decide to leave, which means we are provided for. Secondly, nobody can throw us away unless we're criminal, and that too proven. So if this message goes to all of us who are in, who've qualified for a service and appointed, and not on somebody else's 5-year tenure, political life is totally different because political life is 100% transactional. Because it is a give and take. Political life is most insecure. It's business. I give you this, you get me that. That's why you see a constant struggle. So Gita doesn't apply there. But Gita applies, I believe, my personal view is 100% in our service. So you've come to speak to people who are in administrative service. And if we in our own service start feeling insecure when we have 100% security, is when we, I feel, have not understood the essence of this service. So therefore, for us in administrative service is a great opportunity to understand, to give it nishkam. Anything which we do, there's nothing to take in return. It is my duty to do. I'm here for the purpose of doing. And number two, I'm not an employer even of the government, if you ask me. I don't work for the government. I work for my country and I work for myself. The moment we come into this position that I am not your employer, you may be an employer somebody, but I belong to the Constitution of India. I'm employed by the Constitution of India and therefore I owe it only to my Constitution, which is the law. It can be the law of nature, which is unwritten. It can be the law, which is unwritten. So I feel if that, Ashwini, is ingrained in our services from the training side, that you are coming into nishkam because government is taking care of you. Your family is also taken care of. So you are into nishkam. So therefore, do as much as you can do, but you are already taken care of. What are you asking for in return? Another, the moment you link it with what will happen to me after this decision I take, then you're not into nishkam. Then you're no different from another person who has to depend every 5 years. I'm looking at a decision-making constituency. You've come to Raj Nivas to inspire us, to remind us of this inner calling, which we must recognize, why are we here? And I think that's what we, more aware we are of ourselves, more transformational decision making and service will happen. That's how I get to understand. I'll give you a bit of example of my prison time with prisoners. I remember one day I was walking and prisoners, I had 10,000 of them, each one of them would say, condemn everybody. He did this, he did that, she did this, my judge did this. I'll go and teach a lesson to the judge. And I was walking, I remember distinctly that time. So I was walking with some of my colleagues and I said, and as a police officer, I know they've done something wrong, that's why they're here. So I told him, who will tell them they did something wrong and that's why they're here? But if they don't realize it now, they'll come back again after this tenure of theirs. What do we do? How do we tell these people that they did something wrong and that's why they're suffering? He said, ma'am, I have an idea. I said, what's the idea? He says, can we introduce Vipassana meditation into the prison? I said, what is Vipassana? I'm talking 1994, 93. What is Vipassana? He says, ma'am, that helps you to see yourself constantly, make you aware of who you are and why. Whatever you're doing is who you are. I said, who will come? He said, if you approach somebody in Jaipur, they've got an institute, they'll come. So we approached them, they came. But their condition was, I'll bring Vipassana to you only if you teachers do it first before the prisoners do it. Now who will volunteer as a teacher to do a 10-day silence program? But somehow we use the muscle power and we got these officers done. Friends, the net result of that remarkable meditation program was many prisoners went back to the courts to say, we did it. We did commit a crime and we did it. I told a story, I don't know, to somebody, maybe Neeti, a story of one Norwegian who came to the prison called Leo Gaznier. And after he did the program, he told the lawyer, I want to go to the court. I want to speak to the judge. He said, no, you can only speak to the lawyer. He said, no, I don't want the lawyer. I want to speak to the judge directly. And then the lawyer stepped in. Kiss, why are you going? He said, I want to speak to the judge. And I want to tell him the truth. He says, do you know what it means? You've been caught for drugs. And if you tell the truth, you go straight 10 years. He says, I want to tell the truth. So he went and he told the judge. He said, sir, I want to tell you what happened. You are charging me for smuggling 5 kgs of heroin. No, sir, it was 10 kgs. It was 10 kgs, not 5. I want to know where are my other 5 kgs. And the stage came because when we wanted to find out why he did it, he said, I wanted to set myself free because it was always stuck here. What am I defending? I didn't want to live in my lies. So I think this kind of awareness, if the moment you start practicing and being aware, then you listen to your own word, you listen to what you read, what you write, you hear what you speak everywhere, and you start analyzing yourself, why am I doing this? And you keep refining and refining. I think finally, if we can all take one thing away, which I took a lot from Vipassana, because then we had courses even for police officers, is start listening to yourself. Number 2, reflecting on what am I doing, why am I doing? 3, how much is me and I in it, and how much is the larger good in this? Because I'm here to do good. I'm here to do karma, to do good for others, and not to say, what's my return? I think the essence of Gita will probably be understood. We will probably restart walking the journey of understanding Gita. This is my takeaway. I took it in 93, and it helped me. And I can also, to be honest, what happened before and what was new learning after. A heightened self-awareness. And it never stops because it constantly makes you constantly aware of yourself. You're all the time before a mirror. Why am I doing? Why am I saying? Even if I'm countering a lie, let me tell you. In administrative, you counter lies, you counter falsehood. It's not falsehood or countering for a despite, to punish. No, it's to set things right, to put the record right. And sometimes it's your responsibility to set it right. So somebody may look at very egoistic and somebody might say, it's your duty to set it right. So I would not run away from such a duty without putting my ego. This is how I understand. But there are far too many new learnings from you. And it's today Gurpurav, exactly what Baba Guru Nanak said. Nishkam Seva. That's why he brought, when he brought it, wanted to bring integrity, he brought the Sangat, he brought the Sangeet, and he brought the Nishkam Seva. That's why they take the shoes at the Gurdwaras. Everybody wants your shoe and clean the shoe because they want to lower their own ego and become humble. They want to learn humility by cleaning up and putting shoes. Similarly, they want to sing as a community and they want to do langar and weave the chapatis. It's a perfect fit. In fact, I did say this, I did express it, that today's day, how naturally it fits into Gurpurav day also. When, and the Gita's philosophy is exactly the same which you've told us what Gurpurav or Guru Nanak stood for. I want to thank you once again for spending your time with us, and we love your books. We will try and gift these away hereafter to our folks who we want to reward in any way. Thank you once again.